So coming up in the streets of New York, I mean, these are the times of the 80s.
Right.
These are tough times. These are competitive times. These are times that's about territory. You got to be able to stand up. And in our world, worst thing that can happen to you is go out of business. Mm-hmm. In your world, worst thing that can happen to you is you're out of life. It's that's a completely right. different ball game, right? You could that's get right. killed. So what were some stories or examples you had of power play played against you and power plays that you played against somebody else that was in a more stronger position than you were?
You know, early on, I got a great education. You know, that could be a very treacherous life. Obviously, people, you know that. And when I was a young recruit meaning I had just been proposed into the life, and I now had to prove myself to get my stripes. So you had to do anything and everything you were told to do. And at the time, I was just feeling my way. I had gotten in trouble. I had a few indictments, so I had really gone through it. And I had a couple of businesses going. I had a market, you know, like a market where you have all different stations. You got meat, you got fish, you got the whole thing. So we had a meat division there. And Paul Castellano, who was the boss of the Gambino family at the time, he had a lot of people involved in the chicken business. He's a wholesale chicken guy. So one of his relatives was selling me chickens. We had to buy from him because he was the boss.
Legit business.
It was legit, yeah. I think so. Anyhow, I was buying all my chickens from him. It's Memorial Day weekend. The anniversary is actually coming up. And I buy a load of chickens for him, and I'm selling them to people. We're wholesaling them and giving them away. Memorial Day weekend, beautiful weekend. So we sell to this one woman. On Tuesday, she comes back, and she said, "You sold me bad chickens." I says, "What do you mean?" "Well, they were all filled with maggots." Now, they were only in my freezer for a day, right? So it couldn't have been us. So I said, "I'll take them back." I gave her back the money, the whole bit. So I call up Paulie's guy, and I said, "Listen, I'm not going to pay you for these chickens because there was something wrong with them. There was maggots." He said, "No, you're going to pay me for the chickens." I said, "No, I'm not going to pay you." We go back and forth. He starts cussing me out. I start cussing him out, and so on and so forth. He says, "You know who I am?" I said, "I don't care who you are. You know, I'm a young, brash guy at that time." And I hang up the phone on him. Next thing you know, I get a call from my boss at the time. He was a cop regime. And he says, "Get downtown right away. I got to see you." So I jump in my car. I go downtown. I go to, downtown Brooklyn. I said, "What's the problem? Did you have an argument with somebody on the phone?" I said, "Yeah." I said, "Over these chickens." And I explained the story to him. He said, "Do you realize who that guy was?" And I said, "I know, but he still sold me bad chickens. Do I have to pay, you know?" So he said, "You're in a lot of trouble." That's Paul Castellano's nephew. It got back to Paulie. He's the boss of the Gambino family. "You got a lot of trouble here. You're not supposed to get out of control with a guy like that. You always keep your temper." I said, "Well, what are we going to do?" He said, "Well, we're going to have a sit down with him." He says, "But here's the deal. When we get to that table, you don't open your mouth. I don't care what Paulie says. I don't care what he accuses you of. I don't care what names he calls you. You don't open your mouth, and you don't answer unless we answer for you or we tell you to answer. That's the rules." I said, "Hey, you got it. Whatever
how
I got to do
to
save
time?
My life." I was 23 years old. So we get to the meeting, and I'm getting abused. Pat, he's calling me all sorts of names. "You know who I am. Who do you think you are? I know who your father is, but that doesn't give you a right to talk to my nephew like that." On and on and on and on and on. And I'm not answering. They're answering for me, right? So the bottom line is, he says, "Do you want to buy chickens for me anymore?" And I looked at my guy. I said, "Can I answer?" He said, "Answer." I said, "No, I don't want to buy chickens from you." I mean, you would have thought this was like the biggest deal in the world, right? A couple of pounds of chickens. It was always over about. So, but you know, in that world, everything is very technical. They make a mountain out of a molehill. And you know, the thing, Patrick, at that meeting, what happened at these sit-downs, the old timers were very technical. For instance, rules of a sit-down. Let's make you and I are made guys. We're having an argument. You're lying through your teeth. Lying, every other word is a lie. If I call you a liar, I lose the argument automatically. If I get upset with you and lose my temper, I lose the argument automatically. You gotta know how to keep your mouth shut. You gotta be able to outsmart that person, right? And don't let him make you fall into a trap. Because a lot of times, if an old timer was wrong, he's trying to get you into a trap, so on technicalities, you lose. So I'm starting to figure this out here. So I said, "Look, I don't want to buy chickens from you anymore." I says, "But I'm going to do whatever my boss tells me to do. If he tells me to buy them, I'm going to buy them." I said, I'm a good soldier in that regard. Back and forth. I took all the abuse. And at the end of the day, I didn't have to pay him for the chickens, but I had to continue buying chickens from him. That was the compromise, right? So now I get in the car, and they turn around, and he starts yelling at me for a minute, and then all of a sudden, everything is silent. There's the boss and my capo regime, and they crack up laughing, like this was the biggest, funniest thing. He said, "You, Paulie," I said, "I never seen Paulie get so mad over chickens." He said, "You happen to do that, blah, blah, blah," and we all had a good time over it. But what I learned at that point, I learned just about these technicalities and how you got to keep your head in a meeting like that. You got to learn to outsmart people. You got to be able to read the room. You know, I learned that whenever I went into a meeting like this, I tried to learn the personality, the character of the person I was up against. John Gotti, for instance. You can never let John Gotti think that you won an argument. His ego wouldn't allow it. So you had to figure out a way to outsmart him, to make him think he won, but you actually got what you want. And when you can master that art, you'll do pretty good. And you know, whatever I did in my old life, I was able to apply that to business in life now. So that was my first, but you know, they got over me a little bit, but we kind of compromised, but it was a big lesson for me because that was my first major sit down against a major guy.